I'd like to welcome you today to our Lunch and Learn. I'm Elizabeth Walden. I'm the Communications Manager for U of L Physicians. And U of L Physicians is working very closely with Barb here at the Y to provide a variety of different activities and lunch and learns and wellness screenings and things for the members here. So we're pleased to be here. And I have with me Dr. David Vanlandingham, and he's going to talk with you today about polypharmacy and have you think about, are you taking too many medications? So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Vanlandingham. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, am I good without the microphone, or do you all need me to use the microphone? Do you all want the microphone? Okay. So, like she said, my name is David Vanlandingham, Dr. Vanlandingham. You can call me David. That's not important to me. We're going to be talking today about polypharmacy, and what that is this whole talk. Now, when you all hear the word polypharmacy, is there anything that you all think of? Pharmacy? Going to different pharmacies? What is it? Anything else? All right, so we're going to be talking about medications and how many medications that you're taking. So let's try this. That's actually much better. All right, I'm usually very loud, so I'm not too worried about it. Now, we're going to be talking about polypharmacy and how many medications you're taking. So if I were to say it can sometimes be defined as the number of medications that you're taking, I want you to think about it in your head for a second and think, how many medications might polypharmacy be considered? Just take a little bit to think about that. How many medications would you have to be taking to be considered polypharmacy? So this is prescription and over the counter, whatever you want to include. So let's go here. What do you all think? How many? 3, 2, 10, 2, 7, more than 1, 6. All right. So let's think about the word polypharmacy. Poly means many, and the pharma part is referring to drugs and or medicines. That can be over the counter, can be prescriptions, it can be eye drops, it can be many different things. So here's the question, which is it? Can one drug be considered polypharmacy? No. I hear no, because it's only one, it has to be many. Combination, oh, very good. She said it could be a combination drug. So that could theoretically be it. Anyone else have any thoughts on, can it be one drug be polypharmacy? So we say that yes, it possibly can. If you don't need it, very good. Now, if someone takes all of these, is it considered polypharmacy? Yes. I see a lot of nodding yes. Okay. So, one drug polypharmacy. We have this lovely medication here. We have this guy who takes it. Let's say this medication is for blood pressure. This guy has high blood pressure, and it's working for him. So would that be considered polypharmacy? No, it's doing him something good. It's actually helping him out. Now, let's say we have this woman who does not have high blood pressure, but she's given this blood pressure medication, like you said. If you don't need it, is that then considered polypharmacy? I hear yes, I hear she shouldn't take it. So it's something that she may not need. So we have the same medication in two different people. And yet one may have polypharmacy going on and the other one isn't. So here we have multiple drugs. Is that always polypharmacy? Well, somebody may have multiple medical conditions. And if they have multiple medical conditions, they may need it. However, there may be interactions with those. There may be some forgetting of taking medications or confusing medications because there's too many. the pill burden, which is how many you actually have to take. I mean, if your breakfast consists of 30 minutes of taking medications, you have a large pill burden, right? It may take some time to get all those down. You're thinking, I'm taking too many just because it's taking up too much of my time and it's hard to remember all these. And then the side effects. The side effects are very important of the drugs because they may be causing some harmful side effects, maybe causing some beneficial, some good side effects, depending on what you're going for. So, are all these really needed? So, we have this lovely picture of all these medications. You use that for high blood pressure, just as an example. But what does that cause? A cough. So what do you do for that? You go to the doctor and the doctor says, well, I'm gonna give you something for cough. Okay. So we've added on something for cough, which came from the medication. But your blood pressure still isn't controlled. So what do? They give you another medication. And what does that do? It causes swelling in your legs. So what do? They give you a fluid pill. Okay. So we have two medications that we need and then two more medications to treat the medications and all right. Then we have cholesterol, okay. And then what? Then we might have an ulcer, so we take something to help with that. So slowly but surely, we start adding on medications. Now, four of those we need, two of those we can take off because we don't really need them because they're just treating side effects of the other medication. So why not switch those medications? So polypharmacy can be a result of taking too many because you actually need them, but then they throw on others for you, which you don't need, so then that's a problem. So it's what can we get off of that you don't really need? Now, the other fun thing, forgetting or confusing your medications. Does anybody ever forget or confuse their medications? Anybody ever forget to take them? I know I do. I have to use an inhaler. I take mine every morning and every evening. You know what? I often forget mine. It's part of it. So, we have lovely pill boxes, right? But you know what? Even then, we may forget taking those. And the fun thing is that we've actually had people come in saying, it's okay, I use a pill box. I know what I'm doing. And you know what they do? So, let's look at this picture. We have right there, all those arrows. Do you see those different containers? There's different medications in each container. Now the problem is that some people will put, you know, five different ones in here, two different ones there, eight different ones in here. They'll repeat ones in different days. And so they say, well, it's okay, I'm using the planner. So it's okay. Well, maybe. So the polypharmacy in this case might be, I'm getting confused on how to take them. I'm forgetting to take them because there's just too many. I can't remember all the different times of the day to take it. So again, let me ask you, how many medications would you have to take to be considered polypharmacy? So, in all the research studies and all the lovely articles that they like to write, some people say five, some people say nine medications. And this is the fun part. This is the people who are supposed to be studying this saying these are what we determine to be polypharmacy. Not necessarily what you're taking or if it's appropriate or not, but how many you're taking, which is kind of an arbitrary point of view, but they have to start somewhere. Some say any drug that's not truly needed. Or drugs that are causing bad side effects. Or any amount of medications that are causing the pill burden, too many medications that you're trying to take. So, what do I like to consider polypharmacy? Any drug that is not truly needed, the side effects are worse than the benefits, or there are just too many medications to take. So it can really be a lot of different things. It's not necessarily just a number, even though a lot of people stick with just the number. So is there any other reason that anybody else can think why this might be a problem for people?
Expense.
Very good. The affordability. Can people actually pay for all the medications that they're prescribed? And let's be honest, a lot of times people can't. Or in a lot of people's cases, they go into the donut hole. And then we have the issue where people are having to pay a lot of money out of their own pockets. And people can't afford some of these more expensive medications, which is a problem. And in that case, it's kind of polypharmacy because, again, they have too many medications that they can't take because either they can't afford it, they can't remember it. So, let's talk about the way drugs are tested and why I bring up the side effects and whether it's appropriate and all that. So, we have this lovely medication again. Who does it get tested in when they're making the drug? Who does that get tested in? A sample group? By the FDA. All right, very good. It starts off usually in animals, and then they take it to who? Young, healthy people. Usually in their 20s and 30s who are doing very well with life. And you know what they test? This one medication to make sure it works well. Now, what about real life? We have the people who are actually using it. They're usually older, not in as good of health, and they take this drug along with everything else they're already taking. Now here's the question. Do we know what happens when we take that with that in these people? No. A lot of times, no. We learn from experience, and after it goes out into the market, there may be some testing to see what it interacts with. But to be honest, a lot of times it's only what they see in the trials, which are only in the young, healthy people. So when things actually come out to market, they find many more problems a lot of times with the drugs that actually do have problems. Now, a lot of the medications, there aren't going to be extra problems. So it's fine. But in some of those, they will find more problems. So, who here sees more than one doctor? So does anybody see no doctors? Does anybody see only one doctor ever? For everything? No, I mean all the doctors that you see. You see more than one? More than one? More than one? So, what happens here? You go see this lovely doctor because you need something, something's going on. They give you this medication. Okay. Off to a fine start, because those are fine. Then you have to go to the hospital, and they say, oh, we found all these things going on with you, so what do? We'll give you that. And then you go see the pulmonologist. He gives you an inhaler. You go see this doctor. She gives you some cough syrup and some more medication. You go see these residents at the clinic that you're going to. They give you more medication. You go see the eye doctor. She gives you eye drops. This guy gives you a shot, because you need a flu shot. This lady listens to you, says, take this medication. And you have this doctor that goes, oh my gosh, how did we get all of these medications? And here's, and let me ask you this, and I'm not gonna ask anybody to raise their hands because we don't wanna incriminate any doctors in here. But how many of those doctors, when you've been given a new prescription, have gone through all of your medications to make sure that medication is okay? So we do have some that do. And do they check it every single time that you go in?
Yes.
Good. Because I'll be honest, there are some doctors out there that do not. And then we run into problems. So, what do we do when we leave the doctor's office and they give us a prescription? Where do we go?
Pharmacy.
The pharmacy. And what do they have there? They have prescriptions that we're going to pick up. And then everything else. So we have many things that we can pick up there. Does the doctor always tell you to pick up everything at the pharmacy? Or let me ask you this. Do you ever pick up anything at the pharmacy that the doctor hasn't told you to pick up?
Candy.
That's chocolate. That is a good candy, chocolate. Caffeine, drug. Anyone else pick up any vitamins without asking their doctor? Anybody pick up any herbal supplements without asking their doctor? Calcium pills without asking their doctor? There's reasons that these are important to let your doctor know about because, for example, calcium. What if you're taking a thyroid medication, something like Synthroid or levothyroxine? If you're taking that and you go out and buy calcium, when are you taking them? Because those two actually, the calcium binds to the thyroid medication. Does your doctor know that you're taking that? You go in and get your blood levels tested, and what happens? He says you need more. Is it that you need more, or you need to change when you take your calcium? So these are questions and things you need to think about so that when you go to your doctor, you talk to them about that. And of course, always your pharmacist can answer questions. That's why we're there, is to answer questions. So whenever you have questions, come ask us. So we have the doctor, and then we have you. Who here has arthritis? Or you know someone that has arthritis? Probably, I'm sure that would probably be everyone in here. Okay, so you have a pain in your shoulder. And you say, I have a great idea. I'm gonna go to the pharmacy. And I'm gonna get something there that's gonna help with that pain. Now, of course, we're not gonna ask to say, have you ever done this? But let's just say, have you ever known anyone who has ever done this? Does your doctor know that you did that? We have a yes. Very good. So we do have some people that are telling, and that's good. And make sure that you always do. Because gut arthritis, we have people who go and choose Advil, Motrin, or ibuprofen. We have people who choose Aleve or Naproxen. Now, has your doctor ever talked to you about taking these medications? Yes? And what has he told you?
Not to take certain ones together
because they do the same thing. Okay, so your doctor told you not to take certain ones together because they do the same thing. Very good. Okay, they can cause ulcers in the stomach. Anyone else? She takes it early in the day in the morning. Okay. So, a way to help you remember this is kidney beans, all right? Has your doctor ever talked to you about why these may not be the best for your kidney? Both kidneys, it may be harmful to them. So, you're probably thinking, why are we talking about kidneys and why is there a sink running on here? What does this have to do with each other? All right, I want you to close your eyes for a second. Everybody close your eyes. I want you to imagine something. I'm going to give you something to think about. And when I'm speaking, I want you to imagine it. So we have a sink. And you turn the faucet on, and it's running, 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 running. Now, it's draining just fine. Everything's working fine. Your sink is like that kidney. Now, if you take ibuprofen or naproxen, what happens? You turn off the sink a little bit. You turn that water pressure down. And what happens? Then the water starts draining out faster than it's coming in. So you're not getting enough pressure in the sink, which is not good. So then we take medications for blood pressure. And what do? They open up the drain even more. So then what happens? Then you start getting even more water coming out of that sink. And then your kidneys are going, oh gosh, I don't have enough to go. And then we have kidney injury. And then you throw on the water pills that make you go to the bathroom. That's gonna deplete that water source even more. So in younger people, they can handle, their bodies can handle all this that's happening to them. As we get older, every single person, as we get older, our kidneys don't work as well and we can't adapt to what we're doing to it. Not as well. We can still do it some, but not as well. So we're already hurting ourselves when we take all these medications together. They call it the triple whammy. When you take that ibuprofen or Aleve, an ACE inhibitor like lisinopril, and then a diuretic or the water pill, those all three together are really gonna hurt your kidneys. And that can be dangerous. And make sure that if you're trying to do all those, your doctor knows about it because they might want to talk to you about that. Who here has heartburn? Or knows somebody that has heartburn? Probably a few of you. I hope it's not like this. That might be some really bad heartburn, I'll be honest. You probably ate some really fiery chili that day, and I'll be honest, you might want to be taking something for that. So you have a lot of options. You go to the pharmacy, right? You're like, I've got this burning. Now, what did you take for the arthritis? The ibuprofen, the Aleve? And what does that cause? Some indigestion, can possibly cause ulcers. So what do? I need to go to the pharmacy. I'll pick up one of these, right? Many options. They have a whole row of options. You can go to the pharmacy and say, ooh, that one looks, that's a pretty box. I'll take that. So we have what we call H2 blockers. Who here has ever heard of Zantac or Pepcid? Everybody ever heard of those? Now, what about other options? Is that the best choice for someone who's older? Not necessarily. Okay. Now, of course, I'm never gonna ask you to raise your hand to incriminate yourself, but let's just say, do you know anyone that has ever taken these who's older? Has anybody ever taken, or you know anybody who's ever taken the Pepcid or Zantac, even though they might be older? Yeah. The problem with these, more than likely we cause dry mouth. Good chance to also cause some dry eyes and therefore blurry vision. They could also cause you to sit on the toilet needing a newspaper because you're going to be on there a while. It can cause constipation. And let's be honest, you don't want that. And the other fun thing is, in older people, it can likely cause confusion. Dizziness, drowsiness. So you're thinking, all I had was a little heartburn. Yeah, but now you have all these going on too. All right, so what other options do we have? Prilosec and Prevacid and all those other things, the proton pump inhibitors. Anybody ever heard of these? Anybody know anybody who takes these? Yeah, a few people, yeah, okay. Are these the best option? These would be for heartburn or for ulcers in the stomach, acid reflux. So, what can these cause? Low vitamin B12 levels, which you need for your brain, you need for your body. All right, now, this right here is another issue in older people because as people get older, they tend to eat less meat. And that's where we get B12 from. So we have B12, this causes us to have low B12, which means our levels may get too low. It also causes low magnesium, which could also be a problem, people. And now this is not saying if you take it for a couple weeks, this is long term. So if you're taking it every day for months and years, these things can happen. If you supplement, and that's the thing, that's why you're having to supplement. If you're on one of these, it's because you're needing to supplement because of that. Would you necessarily be normal levels without this? Maybe, maybe not. But this may be contributing to that. Did you know that if you also take these for a long time, it increases your risk of osteoporosis? So possibly breaking your bones. But remember, all this is over the counter, so it's safe, right? I mean, it's out there, you can pick it up anytime. These have also been linked to an increased risk of pneumonia. Now, it's on the shelf. Go to aisle 13. It's on sale right now, right? It's a good deal. It's got to be safe. You can get it without asking anybody. Is it safe? You tell me. So, Tums or calcium carbonate. All those things you can chew up, swallow. Some are chalky, some are smooth, some are more delicious than others. Some have a good flavor, some don't. Pretty good option, except for if you're taking too many, where are you gonna be? Reading a newspaper on the toilet again, because it can cause constipation if you take too many. So if you're, chewing a bottle a day of Tums, you may need to talk to your doctor, because you don't want that. So, weight loss drugs. Can everybody see what I said about that? No. And I have one more thing to say. No. Cow. No. Weight loss drugs, no. Why? Increases your heart rate. That's usually not a good thing if you're not exercising. If you're exercising and your heart rate goes up, good. If you're taking a drug and your heart rate goes up because you want to lose weight, bad. Increase of blood pressure. So you're already taking blood pressure medication because your blood pressure is too high. So we take a weight loss drug to make our blood pressure go up. Wait. That's not good. You don't want to do that. Now, who wishes they could sleep like a baby? You know what? With this, you're going to be awake. You're going to be up. And we need our sleep. And did I mention kidney beans? Yeah, your kidneys are also affected by this. Your kidneys are very tough, but they're also kind of delicate. So while they can handle a lot of different things, if you push them too hard or too far, that's when you run into problems. So weight loss drugs, what's the answer to that? No. Okay. Now, a new favorite thing of mine out at the pharmacy. When I say favorite, let me clarify, I don't mean favorite. It's available at pharmacies now. It used to be by prescription only. It's called Oxytrol. It's a patch. It's for people who go to the bathroom too much, urinary incontinence. Has anybody ever heard of this drug? It's similar to Detrol. It is oxybutynin. This is oxybutynin in a patch. It's over the counter. You don't need to have a prescription for it anymore. You can go pick it up. And people are thinking, well, I go to the bathroom a bit, maybe more than I want to. Let me go try this patch out. First off, it's only for women because they said men shouldn't use this. Not because men don't use oxybutynin, but because if men take it, they may be having problems with BPH, not problems with urinary incontinence. So they take this, it's not helping their BPH. So that's why it's not for men. So if your husband is having, or if you're having problems going to the bathroom and you're a man, don't go get this. It's not for you. It's for women only right now. Now, if you're a woman and you're taking this, since it's only for women right now over the counter, I say no. Why? Did I mention dry mouth before? Does that sound familiar? This is very likely to cause dry mouth. What else is likely to cause? See anything familiar? See that newspaper in the toilet? Yeah. Yeah. That's what's Oxytrol. Yeah. And the best part is Oxytrol helps you with the urinary incontinence, right? But it causes or can cause constipation. And do you know what increases the need to go to the bathroom? Constipation. That worked out well. So we took something to help us not go as much that causes constipation that makes us want to go more. Okay. And then, the other big one, especially in older people, confusion, dizziness, dry eyes. Once again, over the counter, so it's safe, right? It is a great option. It's probably even on sale now because it's new. Does that mean you should get it? No. Make sure you talk to your doctor. So, Oxytrol for women. Now, let's talk about the class of drugs that they're in, like the Detrols and other drugs like that, the Vesicares, you can go to your doctor and get. It decreases 0.6 voids per 24 hours. That means over the course of a day, you went to less than one time. You went 0.6 fewer times each day. So that means over the course of 2 days, you went one less time. Okay, so let's go back. That right there, that's what can happen from this, to go one less time every 2 days. Does it, okay, so the thing is does it help with urgency? Yes, but at what risk? And the thing is that it all depends on your age, how healthy you are. You know, a woman in her 50s that's having problems can probably take it just fine. If a woman is in her 80s and taking it, I would say, please stop. You're probably gonna start experiencing this. You may not experience it on the first one, you may, But if you keep using it, there's a very good chance you'll start experiencing more problems with it. So this is one of those that you, like all medications, talk to your doctor, talk to your pharmacist, because it may or may not be appropriate for you, because it can cause these things. So depending on what study you're looking at for the entire class of drugs, 8.5% to 40% success when taking one of these medications. So that means at best, 4 out of every 10 people actually experience success with one of these drugs. So the chance of it actually really helping you is not great to begin with. It says 1.3 to 6.3% experience adverse effects. Okay, so it doesn't seem like a high number. You think, well, that's not really that high. However, let's look at the next one. 58 to 71% of people. So that means 1 out of every 2 or 3 out of every 4 people that take one of these medications stops taking it within 6 months. Why? It doesn't work for them. They have bad side effects, or because they were given an incorrect diagnosis. And what's the problem with going to pick up something like that over the counter? Did the doctor diagnose what you have? Do you really know that's what you have? Is there something else going on? It may not be the best choice for you, because you may be treating the wrong thing. Does anybody have any questions? And I know that, so we're going back to the whole polypharmacy thing. Are you taking too many medications? And, you know, we could go back. Is it a number? Not necessarily. It's more, is it an appropriate medication? How many are you taking? So it's something to think about with how many you're taking, and you want to discuss with your doctor. And anytime you're about to start taking a new one, talk to your doctor, talk to your pharmacist, because it is important, because it may not be the best option, even if it is over the counter, even if it is a prescription. It may not be the best option, especially if there's other options that might be better options. Any questions? Yes?
This is not really prescribing our own. You mentioned about Synthroid and calcium. So if someone who's taking a Synthroid, which I have two sisters who do, are they to take like the Synthroid one side of the day and the calcium in the evening?
Okay, so the question was, I made a comment about calcium and Synthroid. And when is the best time to take those? So here's kind of the best advice I can give you. If someone is already taking a Synthroid and already taking calcium all at the same time, and they've been on that for a while, then their bodies are absorbing enough of the Synthroid, even though calcium is binding some of it. So therefore, they don't need to space anything out, because if they were to space out the calcium now, they would be getting too much Synthroid. However, if someone's just starting Synthroid, make sure you space those out by at least 2 hours. Preferably more, even 4 would be better. But if you're going to have it within 2 hours, fine. So, so somebody has already taken their Synthroid and then waiting an hour or two to take the rest of them, I say good. Because that way you know there's a very good chance that you're binding up less of that Synthroid. So that's good. Yes? Okay. So he's talking about when he gets a new medication, he gets the side effects and the whole pamphlet of papers that you get when you go to the pharmacy and lists all the side effects and how all these things. And my favorite thing is, you know, it's like it can cause dizziness, it may cause some drowsiness, and may lead up to death. It's like, whoa, 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 whoa. That's a large step. They keep getting worse and worse as you go down. But then he said, at the bottom it says, this is what your doctor feels is best for you, and it is the best choice for you, so you should go ahead and take it, right? Now, that being said, I would say this to that. Anytime that you get a new medication from your doctor, ask them why you're gonna be taking it, what side effects can occur, and really, if it is truly necessary. Because it's one of those things that they think it's probably best for you because it will help with the problem that you're having. But the question is the medication going to cause more problems? We're solving the one, or is it really going to be beneficial? So I would always say, always ask your doctor if that medication is truly necessary and if there's any other options that may cause less side effects or that may cause less interactions with other medications. Yes?
You were talking about heartburn earlier. Mm-hmm. I know the gastroenterologist, I've been on Nexium for 15 years. On TV, they said I'm taking it for 6 weeks. So I asked him about that. And I said, well, is it working? It seems to be, so I'm worried about it. And then you're really suggesting we've been proactive in research on this. It affects memory, it affects cold magnesium, osteoporosis. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the question is, because he's been using Nexium for a long period of time, and he's learned about some of the problems of long-term consequences from these. Now, the thing is that does it happen in every person, these consequences? No. Is it guaranteed that it will cause osteoporosis or low vitamin B12 levels or anything like that? No, it's not going to happen to every person. That being said, if somebody's been on it for 10 to 15 years, the question would be, can we check levels to make sure I'm doing okay? And secondly, the question is, when you're on the proton pump inhibitors or the Nexium or the Prilosex, what were you on it for to begin with? Was it a short-term problem? And I'm talking about a little bit of heartburn that typically, once it's treated for 4 to 6 weeks, sometimes 8 weeks, that problem resolves and you don't have to worry about it anymore. Now, there are some people who, unfortunately, even when they try to come off of it, they're still gonna have problems. So you kind of have to stay on it. And it's one of those risk versus benefits. The benefit being you're not gonna have heartburn, which is not good because it can cause corrosion in the esophagus. It also has the risk. So every person's different. I don't think it's necessary to change doctors. I think it would be a good idea to talk to the doctor about what's happening and whether it would be warranted to try to possibly come off something. And the risk and benefits associated with that of coming off of it. So it's not necessarily always wrong to be on something or on one of these medications, but there may be other options that you may be able to come and do later or to possibly get off these in time. Yes. The question is probiotics that you can take, that you can buy over the counter as well. Are they any good? Do they help? Are they really worth it? Studies have shown that they're really not that beneficial. They're really not that beneficial. They're really not that great. And the other issue being that, especially in some patients who are taking antibiotics that are wiping out the bacteria that are normally there, and some doctors say, supplement with probiotics. Some people actually get infections from the bacteria in the probiotics that are even worse. So eat healthy. If you eat healthy, you're gonna replenish a lot of those bacteria anyways. That being said, if you wanna eat yogurt with the live bacteria, you know, if you have one of those a day, you're gonna be doing yourself some good. Now, when you take the mega doses of probiotics, is it really gonna benefit you to a great deal? Probably not. I myself would not spend any money on it because it's not going to do probably that much good for you. Yes?
The doctor put me on the pump inhibitor, the Prilosec, to go with an arthritis medicine, Voltaren. Mm-hmm. Is there something better to go with that Voltaren than the pump inhibitor?
Okay, so the question is, if someone is taking an NSAID, like the ibuprofen, like the naproxen, like Voltaren, and then the doctor also gives them the proton pump inhibitor like a Prilosec to help with that, because issue with the ibuprofens and things, they're increasing your risk of getting an ulcer. Now, when they put you on these proton pump inhibitors, the Prilosecs, that's decreasing the risk of getting the ulcer. So if you're gonna be on long-term treatment of those arthritis medications, then it's probably gonna be beneficial to stay on something like the Prilosec, because it's gonna prevent an ulcer, or at least that's the hope that it will prevent an ulcer. So the question is there any difference between over-the-counter omeprazole or Prilosec and the prescription omeprazole? Likewise, the over-the-counter Prevacid and the prescription Prevacid? No, there's no difference. I believe the Prilosec, the salt form that it's in, the way it's combined is slightly different, but it makes no difference as far as what it's doing. It's just the way they formulate it, but it's doing nothing different as far as what it does to your body. The long-term risk associated with it, that will be the same. Either one should work. That being said, depending on the strength that you're getting, you may have to take two or however many you have to take. So, yes. What supplements do I feel are important? Well, given that in this country we tend not to eat the best diets, me included, a multivitamin. Beyond that, if you are a vegetarian or vegan, I would recommend B12. But that's one of those that I would still check with the doctor to make sure your levels are low, because there's no need to. Because the thing is that if you take it and you don't need it, you're just going to pee it out, so you're just paying out money. Same thing with multivitamin. What you don't need, you're just peeing out, but it's better to be safe to make sure you get everything that you need. Other than that, and once again, the irons, those sort of things, you'll need if you need it, and your doctor will let you know, and there's a blood test to tell you that. But as far as supplements, as far as herbal products go, I don't recommend any. As far as glucosamine chondroitin, I don't recommend it. And the reason I don't recommend that is because the molecule that it is, it's too large to even pass through your gut. So all you're doing is taking it, it's going through your gut, and you're voiding it. So you're just flushing money down the toilet. Calcium, it depends on who you are. If you have osteoporosis, definitely. If you're an older woman, very good likely chance you'll need it. Older men, maybe, maybe not. If somebody has had heart problems, if a man has had heart problems, studies have shown that if they supplement extra calcium and get too much, they're likely to have more heart problems. So not everyone should take calcium. So,
Vitamin D,
okay, that's one that there's a very good chance you're gonna need it. Not everyone does. The majority of people in this state and northern states and states of the west and east of us, not so much in the south, but most people in this state are gonna need vitamin D supplementation. Maybe not, depending on what you're drinking, eating, if you're the foods, you know, cereals that are fortified with certain things, you may not need it, but for a lot of people, it'd probably be a good idea to get your vitamin D levels tested, because there's a pretty good chance you're gonna need something.
What about magnesium?
Magnesium, I would say no. Unless your doctor tells you you need it, do not take it. I'm sorry?
CoQ10.
Should you take CoQ10? If you are taking a statin, like Crestor, Lipitor, Pravastatin, anything like that, I recommend CoQ10. It's not that you have to, because the evidence is kind of out on whether or not it's truly important. It's one of those that those medications can cause the CoQ10 levels in your body, which affect your heart, to go down. Now, the effects of that, we're not really sure. So it's one of those that if you're on one of those, I say it's probably not a bad idea to take it. If it's doing you any good, I don't know. If it's really harming you, probably not. So that's one of those kind of to be on the safe side. If you're not taking a cholesterol medication, you shouldn't need it. If you are taking a cholesterol medication, you can take CoQ10 if you want to. It's one of those that I don't really think you have to or you don't have to. It's kind of if you think that it might be helping you, honestly, the jury's still kind of out on that. Vitamin C, eating a healthy diet should get you everything that you need. A multivitamin will get you everything that you need. Anything that you go over the 100% of your daily limit, you're just peeing out. So you're just wasting money. So. Calcium for most women, especially if they have osteoporosis, yes, for sure. For most women, there's more than likely I would recommend it unless there's some reason you shouldn't have it because your calcium levels are too high. But for most women, they're probably going to need it. In men, depending on their age and if they've ever had heart problems, if a man has had heart problems and they're older, then if they take extra calcium and get too much, it's actually more likely to cause more heart problems. So that kind of depends for men.
Vitamin D?
E, no. That's a simple one, no. There are slight differences. The citrate is a little bit easier to absorb. So the calcium citrate or calcium carbonate, honestly, either one's gonna be fine. You're gonna get what you need from it. Some are a little bit easier on the stomach, but beyond that, there's really, in my opinion, really no difference between the two. That being said, when you take them, you can only absorb so much calcium at one time. So split it up at two times during the day, once in the morning, once at night. Don't take it both in the morning or both at the night because you'll just get about half of it and the other out goes straight to the toilet. Zinc. Another one that if you truly need it, it'd be unlikely that you'd be low on it, but I mean, I don't think most people would need any supplementation of it. You're probably not getting too much good from it.
Is calcium,
the question is calcium as important for osteoarthritis as it is for rheumatoid arthritis? It's osteoporosis that it's good for. The osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis are going to be inflammation type things, and that's not the calcium that you really need for that. It's osteoporosis, which is the weakening of the bones, that you need the calcium for.
Okay, so the calcium doesn't affect
the calcium in itself is not affecting osteoarthritis. It is affecting bones, which is part of osteoarthritis, but yeah. Thank you all.